morning. Good morning. How's everybody doing out there? Yes, there are people out there, in case you were wondering. We want to say good morning, and we are celebrating our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's why we gather together every Sunday, because He's risen. He's risen indeed, and we're excited about that. And we want to say a special hello to those watching from home. We hate that you didn't get to join us last week because we were outside. And you guys, did y'all have a good time, those who made it? Yes, we did too. And it was a great time together. I want to say a special thanks to Kirk Johnston and all of those who helped set up and tear down to make that special service outdoors just a great time together. And we thank the Lord for that. I have several announcements this morning, so if you can hold on as we go through them. I want to continue to remind us each week to be mindful of the COVID precautions that we put out as we seek the safety of each other as we gather together in community. There's offering boxes on the wall in the back if you want to give each week, or if you want to give online, you can continue to do that. And many of you are watching from home and you don't have the opportunity to come in and drop it in a box, so feel free to do that. Also, when at the end of service, we want to encourage you to go outside and fellowship instead of being in here so that others might be feeling comfortable enough to talk with you outdoors. So just take the party outside is what I'm saying, okay? We are very thankful that the journey groups are coming up very, very soon. They're starting this week. And I just want to challenge you as we pursue biblical community together that you have the opportunity to meet in journey groups either in person, if that's your comfort zone, or you can meet online. So we have four total, and I'm going to walk through them and let you know what's going on. If you'd like to be a part of one of these journey groups, please sign up on the background table. You can use your own pen so you can keep your own germs. That would be very helpful. And the best thing you can do is if you see the name of a leader on this slide or through an email and you're like, man, I'd like to be in their journey group, if you could just contact the leader and say, hey, put me on your roster, that's really the best way you can do that. So I'm going to walk through the leaders in the groups. Again, we have three groups available for small groups. They're starting this week, three in person and one virtual. Okay, so the first is Chris and Lori Hale. Chris is in the back. If you want to raise your hand, Chris, that's Chris. And they meet Mondays at 6:30, and their house is in Rose Hill. If you want to know that, the address is right there. And if you want to know how you can meet up with them this week, I know it's Labor Day on the 7th, so I don't know exactly what they're going to be doing this week, but you can contact Chris. Then the next group is David and Anna Lyles. That's me, and my wife is right there. And we are meeting on Tuesday nights. There was a misprint last week. That was my bad. We're meeting on Tuesday nights at 6:30 at Brett and Megan Stripes' house. And their address is there as well. Please let us know if you want to be a part of our group. The third group is Justin and Amber Jeans. They are meeting on Wednesdays at 6:30 at their new house. And it is off of River Road. And so their address is right there. And the last group is Tyler and Carly Brooks. And they're watching from home right now. And they're doing virtual group on Thursday at 6:30. So I know, especially I'm speaking to those that are at home right now, there's several families from our church body who are not feeling comfortable meeting together because of health concerns and safety concerns. And so we just want to encourage you, especially that this group, Tyler and Carly Brooks's group, would be a great option for you because they're meeting virtually. So I hope you will contact them and let them know that you want to be a part of their group. All right, does everybody get the groups? If you want to know what we're covering, we're just going to be walking through the Bible together, and so we're going to be discussing that together and just trying to bear one another's burdens and spend time in the Word of God together, so it's going to be a great time. The rotation lasts from September to November, so the schedule is available online. All right, some more announcements. With Pastor James stepping down from eldering in mid-October, that's coming up very shortly, we have a great need for more elders at Connection Fellowship, so I will not be the only elder at Connection Fellowship. So we are praying through that, and we have been praying that for a long time, and we're asking God to raise up some biblically qualified men to serve in those roles, either as paid or non-paid elders. And I'm asking you for three things this morning, only three. I'm asking you to continue praying that God would do this because we need God to do that for us. Second, I'm asking you to continue to pray that God would raise up men according to the qualifications of 1 Timothy and Titus, so the book of Titus. So I'd love for you guys to check those qualifications out as you pray through them. I'm just going to read a couple for us right now out of the book of 1 Timothy chapter 3. So 1 Timothy chapter 3 says that if anyone aspires to the office of overseer or elder, that is, he desires a noble task. Therefore, an overseer must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, sober-minded, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not a drunkard, not violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own household well with all dignity, keeping his children submissive. For if someone does not know how to manage his own household, how will he care for the church of God? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become puffed up with conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must be well thought of by outsiders so that he may not fall into disgrace, into a snare of the devil. So the main three qualifications there is they need to have a desire, they need to be qualified in their character, and then they need to be able to teach the word of God. And so we recognize that the Holy Spirit raises up men for that role. And so here's my third request for you. As you read through 1 Timothy 3 and those qualifications in Titus as well, I'm asking you to let me know, and Pastor James, until October 18th, whether someone lays someone on your heart from this congregation, or maybe outside of this congregation, or maybe the Lord lays on your heart you. So just let me know. And I'm confident that the Lord is going to provide the people that he wants and the timing that he wants. So if you're not confident, jump on board with my confidence, because I know God's going to do it. So a couple more announcements. So as many of you know, in the last several months, we've had significant rain damage done in this room, okay? Not right there. That's just a coffee spill. But there's a lot of those coffee spills as well, okay? And that rain damage was on that back wall under the sound booth. Sorry, guys. You guys okay? You got your galoshes on back there? And what we're doing right now is we're currently looking at what it would take to replace this carpet in this room because of the significant rain damage and also because of how old it is. And we also would like to replace some of the carpet in the children's rooms. It's ripped up and torn, and it's very old as well. And we also want to replace the sign out in the church yard. It's so faded. You don't know if you're coming to Connection Fellowship or what. You don't know because it's so faded you can't see it. And I wanted to say that maybe it was at the end of last year, we had some leftover money saved, which God has been so generous financially to our church, and we call that leftover money's capital outlay, and what we did was we voted as a congregation to use that money for tech upgrades so we could do things like live stream, and we have finished those upgrades. Also, we had some money earmarked for mission trips, which unfortunately we weren't able to go on 2020, so those were canceled, and we don't know when the next ones we would be able to do in the future, even in 2021, but we're hopeful. But what happens is with that money left over, we have about $7,600 in that money, that total, okay? So this is what we're doing. Pastor James and I are suggesting the church uses those monies for the mentioned renovations. And we know we're renting this property, but we still want to steward it well, okay? So there's a tension there. There's a balance there, right? We want to rent it, and people say, let's not dump money in here. But we've been here, and we don't know how long we're going to be here, so we want to steward it well. We want to keep things clean. We want to keep things safe as much as possible. We want the children to be able to crawl on the carpet and not get something old in their mouth, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's our heart's desire. So what we're suggesting is that we don't touch any of the building fund money or the Greater Gospel Impact money, but we use some of this money that the Lord has allowed us to have left over and put them towards some of the renovations. So I want you to please prayerfully consider that. That's our desire from the elder team. I'm giving you that this morning. And in the near future, if the Lord allows us to do that, we're going to bring it before the congregation, and I wanted you to know about that. Last thing, I said that the announcements were going to be long, and I'm a man of my word, okay? I did that. All right, missionary partnerships. I'm talking about a lot of transition going on. With the Nelson family coming back from Cape Verde, they're on the wall if you're curious who they were. They're coming back from Cape Verde, and they're taking a part-time missions position in the States, actually in Greenville, South Carolina, so they're going to be neighbors. We're excited for them about that. Also, the Hollies, the family that we're supporting in South Dakota, missionaries, their transition back to South Dakota to go home and spend time with family. That leaves us some gaps in our missionary partnerships, but we're so grateful for those that we have left, the Ribordes in Greenville and also the Shotlighteners in India. Great mission partnerships. I hope you're on their updates. But with those gaps, we're asking the Lord to let us know if there's anybody who he would want us to support, maybe in the United States. So, I mean, anywhere really. So just be prayerfully considering that. We don't have to add an extra person for the missionary money fund support that we do for missionaries, but we are asking God and praying about that. So please continue to pray along with me. There's a lot of things to pray for, right? Right. So we are praying, and you can join us every Thursday to fast and pray as a congregation if you want to, a meal or some coffee or whatever you love, and we'll look to God who we trust, who's our rock. How about that? Does that sound good? Amen. All right, if you guys want to stand, we're going to pray through Psalm 37 together. Actually Psalm 36, and we're going to pray for some of these things that I mentioned, and then Kirk's going to lead us in song together. All right, Psalm 36, let's ready our hearts before the Lord. Lord God, as I look at Psalm 36 in the first four verses, I'm reminded that man is full of sin. Lord, we're full of pride. Lord God, we reject what is good many and most days. And yet, Lord, the contrast in this text is that you are good and you're perfect. So we just celebrate verse 5 as we gather together. We don't put our hope in men. We don't put our hope in each other, Lord. Some trust in horses and some trust in chariots, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Lord, the righteous run into you and we are saved. Lord, you are our tower, our strong refuge. You are our mighty God. A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing, Lord. You are our constant, and we proclaim that you're great and faithful today. We pray along with Psalm 36, and we say, your steadfast love, O Lord, it extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Lord, your righteousness is like the mountains of God. Your judgments are like the great deep. Man and beast you save, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. O Lord, it's so amazing. Lord, would you make it more precious to us each and every day that though we are messed up sinners, Lord, you came to redeem us and you love us with an everlasting love, Lord. Your word says in Romans 8 that nothing will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Nothing. And so we come and we celebrate that today. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. The children of mankind take refuge in the shadow of your wings. And so that's what we do, Lord, as the nations rage, as there's chaos in the streets, Lord, as people don't know which way's up. Lord, as I talked to so many people this week who didn't know you, Lord, and they were lost and empty and searching, Lord, and I had the truth to give them. We're reminded that there's only refuge in the shadows of your great wings, God. You're like this mighty bird whose pinions and feathers are so great, and you protect your people as we come under you in faith. Lord, your word says that we feast on the abundance of your house. You give us drink from the river of your delights. Lord, everything we have is a gift that has come from your hand, Father. Lord, I thank you that your word says that with you is the fountain of life, and in your light do we see light. So I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come and you would magnify Jesus in our hearts and our minds today as we sing and as we pray and as we hear the preached word. Lord, that you would magnify your great name, that we would see you for who you are truly, and we would delight, we would celebrate. Lord, you would stir in our hearts that we might worship in spirit and in truth, Lord. In your light do we see light. Lord, oh, continue your steadfast love to those who know you and your righteousness to the upright of heart. Lord, let not the foot of the arrogant come upon us, nor the hand of the wicked drive us away Lord, there the evildoers lie fallen and are thrust down, unable to rise, Lord. We come to you with great humility this morning, but Lord, you said if we lack wisdom, that if we ask, you would give generously and without finding fault. So we pray for wisdom and we pray for your direction. And I remember in the early church, as they prayed and as they fasted together, you rose up leadership in their midst. You called out Paul and Silas and sent them on mission. So we're praying in light of that and asking that you would raise up godly, qualified men to pastor this church. And we're so thankful for those that you've brought in the past into our lives and how they shepherded us faithfully. Lord, we pray and thank you that you have risen up journey group leaders, four to be exact. Thank you for answering our prayers, Lord. And we pray that as we seek to gather together this season, Lord, that you would pour out your spirit in our midst and that we would fellowship and that you would produce true and genuine community, that we would gather together around your name. And I pray for even those at home right now that they would desire to be in community, even through digital means, if that would be your will. We pray that you'd raise up missionary partners for us to support, if that would be your will. We pray that while we're here, that we would not stop on your mission to love you, God, with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves, that Connection Fellowship would make disciples of all nations, Lord, that we'd see people saved more than ever before in this day, Lord. There's so many who don't know you, and we're praying that you would give them the new birth, people in our families, Lord, people that we work with, people that we meet randomly on the streets, Lord. Draw them, we pray, for the glory of your name. Save them, Lord. Help us to be a part of making disciples, teaching them everything that you've said, Lord. And we want mission first. We don't want building first and carpet first, but we pray that as we faithfully pursue others in your mission, Lord, that we would take care of the things that you've given us to steward. And Lord, it would even be a reflection to others that come into this building that we love them. Lord, we pray for people in our bodies like Josh Francine, who lost his brother the other month, and Anna, who lost her brother, Kevin Daly, who lost his spouse several years ago, Roger Simmons, who lost his spouse several years ago. And we know that we don't understand all of what they're going through, but Lord, you do. And I pray that you administer to them, and Lord, that you'd remind them that you're near to the brokenhearted, that you love your people, and you would strengthen them and bear them up. And Lord, help us to bear their burdens, Lord, because we love them and you love them. Minister your peace to them today, Lord. And as we think about Labor Day today, Lord, we want to thank you for allowing us to live in this nation. Lord, you've been so gracious, Lord, to allow us the spiritual freedoms that we have, the religious liberties to be able to gather like this. We know other countries don't have it. We thank you for how you've blessed our economy over the years. And Lord, you've given us jobs that we've had, that we've been able to work and provide for our families and to enjoy our labors. And so we just give you thanks, God, on this Labor Day weekend. And Lord, we praise you, Lord, that we have the capability to work, and Lord, that you supply for us through that. And we honor you today as the giver of every good and perfect gift. And we thank you that the gospel tells us that even in our labors, Lord, it's not an earning, Lord, it's a celebration. So we celebrate the fact that we're free in you, Christ, and we pray that you bring revival in our nation by first beginning to revive your church in our nation. And Lord, that you would be our greatest desire and delight. And that as we work in our jobs, that we would see that they're a part of the mission, and that we proclaim you to every man, woman, and child. And that God, you would receive all the glory. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, O Lord, but to your name give the glory. Not to us, O Lord, not to us, O Lord, but to your name give the glory. Lord, not to us, O Lord, not to us, O Lord, but to your name give the glory. And we pray that in the powerful name of your risen Son, our Lord, our King, our Master, Jesus Christ, the name above every name. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. The lights are going to go out and we're going to sing together.
shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me, for my God is with me. Whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, never let go through the calm, through the storm. Oh no, never let go in every high, every low. Oh no, never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Even though I walk valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. I will fear no, I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. If my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, never let go in the storm, through the storm. Oh no, never let go in every high, every low. Oh no, never let go, Lord. I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Oh no, oh no, never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, never let go in every high, in every low. Oh no, never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Oh no, never let go through the calm, through the storm. Oh no, never let go through the calm, every low. Oh no, never let go, Lord, you never let go. Go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Draw me close to you, never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say, my desire. No one else will do. Cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth in your help me find a way to bring me back to you. Father, we pray, God, that you would be near, Lord, those of us who call on your name through your Son, Jesus, you are near to us, God. In fact, your presence, your very Spirit lives within us. And so, Holy Spirit, we pray now that you would come in boldness and in power and strength and mind and refuge and peace and comfort and wisdom and faith, and that you would speak through your word, that you would accomplish what you have planned, what you have set forth, Lord, that we would be conformed even more this day to your image, Jesus, that you would tear down the strongholds in our hearts, in our minds, in our lives, that you would remind us that through Christ we are more than conquerors, and that nothing, neither life nor death, nor principalities and powers, nor anything, death or life, can separate us from the love that you have for us. So we pray, God, that you would remind us today of your nearness to us, that you are an ever-present help in time of need, that you are our refuge, you are our strength, you are our joy, Lord, and you are our heart. And so we pray today that you would do that, the things that we have asked for your glory and for our good. Thank you for your love, God. Thank you that you see us. You see us for who we are and all of our brokenness, and you still choose to love us. And you never stop. You never let go of us, God. Thank you for those promises based on who you are. And we ask these things in the sweet name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for singing and praying with us. You can be seated.
Well, I think it is safe to say, because of our place in history and because of certain technological advancements, that we are more connected with people than ever before, right? And I use that term connected very, very loosely. I can talk to people throughout the day by just pulling out this metal square from my pocket. Yes, my phone. And I can send an emoji over text message, the perfect picture that perfectly communicates what I'm feeling without the use of words. I can send that immediately and somebody can receive it and they can know, smiley face, squinty eyes, turned on its side, tears coming down. They get me, you know what I'm saying? They get the core of who I am when I send that, right? I can be linked with others through Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, Pinterest, Instagram, TikTok, or whatever else might get created this week and express myself, right? And yet, check out the statistics. The statistics say that even though that's true, that people are more lonely and more miserable than ever before. Did you know that? Especially because of COVID. Now, why is that? And I want you to listen to me very carefully. That's because we must never confuse connectedness with true community. We must never confuse connectedness with true community. See, I think our culture longs for true community. I mean, deep down, whether they realize it or not. I think we see that in our choice of entertainment. What do I mean by that? In the past 30 years of TV, what are some of the highest rated shows of all times, okay? Any guesses out there? Highest rated shows of all times in the last 30 years. Cheers. Do you guys remember that one? Okay. Right? Seinfeld, Friends, Parks and Rec. Why? What does that tell you about our culture? Well, I think part of it is that people want to be a part of a group where everybody knows your name, right? A group where you can be both fully known listen, and yet fully accept it. I think people want that deep, deep down. People want to be free to dance around in a fountain like a crazy person with a bunch of your friends, right? That really, really gets you, okay? Who listen to you, who care for you, friends who would say to you, even when things are at their worst and you feel like an absolute failure, they say, I'll be there for you. Yes, they say that. When the rain starts to pour, I didn't even watch Friends, sorry, but I think that's how it goes, right? Want more proof that our culture longs for true community? Just give most people in our culture 2 seconds of downtime or less. When there's nothing happening, nothing's going on, when the world has stood still at the stoplight when they're driving, and what's the first thing they do? Boom! They pull out the phone, right? What's the first thing that happens when they're listening to their spouse explain something from their job that they really don't understand for just 5 seconds? What's happening? Well, the phone's getting checked, okay? And that's sad, but that's happening, right? They're looking on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram feeds. It's like we have this insatiable desire to know others. I mean, like, really know them. I mean, like, know what they had for breakfast every morning. Okay, that is a little creepy, right? Like, they want to know what people believe about every single subject, all right? From minute to minute, hour to hour, that's where our culture is. What else? Where else do I see this longing for true community? Again, where people don't realize it. I mean, this past week, I talked to 4 men. And for 3 of them, it was the first time I had ever met them, okay? And these 4 men's ages spanned from 25 years old to 65, okay? Different education levels, different personalities, different ethnicities, different religious backgrounds, but what did they all have in common? Well, I think they were lonely. I think they were hungry for something that they didn't even realize. I mean, I think they wanted to talk. I think they wanted to be heard. I think they wanted people to know that they hurt. I think they wanted people to know their experience. I think they wanted people to know their stories and who they are, right? And that was just this past week. So where does this desire come from? Where does this desire to be in community or to have meaningful relationships with other actual human beings come from? Well, that's a great question. I think it comes from our Creator. I think it comes from our Creator and is a part of our original design. And that leads me to my first point in the beginning of a series that we're going to be doing for the next 5 or 6 weeks. And my first point is this: we are or were created for community. Created for community. First point. And I want us to look back to the beginning. I mean, like, way back to the beginning, like back to Genesis, to the origin story of us and how we were designed. And as God was speaking the universe into existence in the opening chapters of the Bible, he's showing his greatness, his power, his glory, and he's filling an empty canvas with brilliant images and colors. Earth and animals and then us get created, right? And in Genesis 1:26, what does it say? It says, then God said, and it'll be on the back for you. Then God said, let us, it'll be on the back screen for you. Then God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, us, our. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. What does it mean when God says make man in our image after our likeness? Why does God use the plural to speak of himself? Well, there's a lot going on there, but at the minimum, I think we are reminded that our glorious God has eternally existed in community. And when I say that, I'm referring to the doctrine of the Trinity, which is foundational to the Christian faith. See, God is one who has eternally existed as 3 distinct persons. Okay, should I go any further? Mind blown, right? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And what has that community eternally been like between the Godhead, right? Before creation existed. What did that community look like? Anybody know? Perfect, right? Perfect love, perfect unity, perfect enjoyment. Can you imagine it, right? Between the Godhead, it's really actually very exciting to think about. No arguing ever. only outdoing the other in honor since eternity past, right? And one author says this, before any sort of human community existed, there was God dwelling in perfect, loving harmony in his threefold being. And let's just pause right now and worship our triune God, because that's amazing right there. And our first parents, Adam and Eve, were made in his glorious image. And what I gather from that is everyone since then has been hardwired for community, like in your DNA, okay? Created from community for community. And I think that's why even introverts desire community, just not too much of it, right? But even introverts desire community, like face to face, like let's like touch skin and let's talk, right? I think that's why actually we are obsessed with connecting with others through the not social enough social media platforms. They're not social enough. They're not social enough for what you were designed for. This hardwiring is why we try not to give up on at least some form of community in the midst of COVID, right? Even if you're like concerned with your own health, that's why you don't want to give up on at least some form of community, even in the midst of COVID. That's why you don't want to give up on community, even if you've been deeply hurt by someone else. I hate it if that's your history. If you've been abused by someone else in your family or within a church or within your workplace, that's why people don't give up on community, I think. I think that's why as a culture, even when our self-sufficient and selfish hearts try to keep us behind our privacy fences. You know what I'm talking about? Like to get home from work and take our little cars and go behind our privacy fences and put down the garage door so that we can go back into hiding in our room with our big flat screens. It's even then that we eventually want to peek out the windows to the world around us and engage into face-to-face interactions with some non-digital people, okay? We were made for it. This being created for community is even seen in our Creator's conversation with the first human, Adam. Remember Genesis 2:18? We'll put it on the screen for you. Then the Lord God said, it is, help me out, not good. Let's do it one more time. Then the Lord God said, it is that the man should be, I will make for him a helper fit for him. Many people note that after God created the wonders of each of the 6 days, light, then atmosphere, dry ground, then plants, sun, moon, stars, then birds, sea animals, then land animals, God says at the end of each of those days in which he has made, what does he say over those days? What does he say? Y'all know? What does he say? Good, right? And on the seventh, the pinnacle of his creation was made. Who's the pinnacle of his creation? Help me out, mankind. And over the pinnacle of his creation, he says this phrase. What does he say? No, over the pinnacle of his creation, mankind, he says, very good. Thank you for helping me out over here. Okay, we track it. Everybody track it with me, because the next part is not going to make sense if you're not tracking with me, okay? Good, 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 good. I hope that was six. Mankind, here we go. What? Very good. Thank you. You guys are here today. They're here. People online watching, there are people here. They're not cardboard cutouts. They're here. Okay. But what does he say when man is by himself? What does he say over isolation? Ah, see? You guys see? Tracking with me? Okay. He says, not good. You guessed right. You're here. Okay. Then the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. Yes, marriage is one of the ways. Listen, the context is marriage, right? Marriage is one of the ways the not goodness of yourselfness is overcome. But it's not the only way. God has given us biological family, friends, co-workers, and most importantly, his bride, his church, so we would not be alone. Is this true? Amen. Notice I didn't say God gave us pets in that list, okay? Now, hey, I love my dog, okay? I got a Samson, you know, he's a puppy, all right? He's an English lab. He's about 9 months old. I love my dog, but Samson wouldn't be sufficient community to overcome the not goodness of Adam's aloneness. I mean, Adam had all the animals there named in the story, in the context, right? And pets will not be enough for us. Even if we dress them in sweaters, okay? Even if we do that. It's not going to be enough. We need others made in his image, in his likeness. We were created for it. I hope you don't misunderstand what I'm about to say, okay? Don't misunderstand this, but many argue that Jesus is all you need, okay? That's true. But I think many argue it in a way that is unhelpful when they end up pitting Jesus against his body, when they end up pitting Jesus against Christian community, okay? It's both and, right? It's both and. And we need to remember that, right? Genesis 2:18 says that true community was God's idea, his design for mankind. And in actuality, when we begin to understand the fullness of what took place at redemption through the cross and the resurrection and what it means to be united to the body of Christ by his Spirit, in one sense, to choose others is to choose Jesus. Are y'all tracking with me? And to not to choose others is actually to reject Jesus. Are you getting what I'm saying? That's why I start to become super concerned when people say, yeah, I'm a Christian, but I don't hang out with Jesus' body. Right? That type of behavior is a red flag to me that something is deeply wrong within an individual. Second point. Broken community, all right? So we have created for community, or we were created for community, and the second point is broken community. If you're following the storyline so far in Genesis, if you're following so far, things are going well, right? Creation, first man, first woman, walking in the cool of the garden with our Creator, what a community, right? Experiencing the goodness of community, God's way, and then in enters who? Satan, the snake. And community gets wrecked, okay? Where does the demise of true community begin in that story? As soon as Adam and Eve, listen to me, church, stop listening to God. That's when the demise of true community comes into the picture. Genesis 3:1, if you don't believe me. The serpent turns to Eve and seductively speaks through his forked tongue and says, "Has God really said?" And that was the snowball of doubt that eventually begins the avalanche of unbelief that destroys the loving harmony between God and the first humans right there on the pages of Scripture. And following along in Genesis, we see this ripple effect of sin's tidal wave, and the blame shift game begins within a fractured community, right? And people begin to pursue self-protection and self-justification at all costs, even if it means the loss of true fellowship with God and man. And it sounds all too familiar, doesn't it? It does. Chapter 3, verse 1 in Genesis said, God said, "Who told you that you were naked?" Speaking to Adam and Eve. "Have you eaten of the tree of which I have commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me the fruit of the tree and I ate." Whose fault was it? It was God's fault. Then it was the woman's fault, right? Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" And the woman said, "The serpent, it's his fault. He deceived me and I ate," right? It's everybody's fault except for mine. The snake is cursed as a part of the consequences of sin. And in verse 16, there is going to be an ongoing loveless power struggle within the community we call marriage as a result. And Genesis 3:16 tells us about it and says in Genesis 3:16, "Your desire shall be contrary to your husband, but he shall rule over you." And in marriage, it will look like an unwillingness to submit to the God-given role and function. For the husband, it's a failure to sacrificially and tenderly lead his wife. For the wife, it will be a failure to be the submissive helpmate. And it's going to look like all-out war within the community of marriage. It's like a two-year-old walking up to a baby grand piano and taking its toy and just slamming it down the row of keys. There will be no harmony within that community, right? And sin will so corrupt the human heart that it won't just affect marriage. It doesn't stop there if you're following the story of Genesis. It goes from marriage to siblings that come from that marriage. And it goes from those siblings that make up families to society as a whole. And shortly after, Genesis 4:8 says, Cain is letting sin rule over him. And angry, jealously, he kills his brother Abel. Then in Genesis chapter 11, sin is shattering the whole society in a community that was intent on disobeying God's decree to be fruitful and multiply and spread his image across the globe. Instead, stays put and builds a tower to make a name for themselves. And what happens? God comes in judgment. Confusion takes place. People are dispersed, and the building project at Babel is left unfinished. So we were created for community, and yet now because of the fall and our sin, something dark and sinister takes place of the beauty of community. And guys, it's beautiful. What God intended is beautiful. And what dark and sinister thing takes place of beautiful community? Selfish party of one, okay? That's what takes place. Life becomes all about the self. We either pursue, listen, this is very fascinating. We either pursue a false version of biblical community because we use people to meet our needs, our selfish needs. You see how that's a false version of true community? Okay? You think, oh, I'm a community person, I'm a community guy. But really, the motivation proves that you're anti-community because you're using people for your needs. Or we avoid true community because we think it's too costly. We would rather pursue our own interest and the joy that we think we will gain by protecting ourselves from people, so we seek solitude. Either way, it's a bad deal, right? Either way, we are giving over to the kingdom of self, the kingdom of one. And the author that I'm about to quote says that this selfish, self-focused kingdom follows five self-expressions. And I want you, as I list these down, I want you to write down and see if any one of these is you, okay? So here's the five self-expressions of the self-kingdom. One, self-reliance. We are proud of our ability to deal with our own problems and challenges without the help of others. That's the kingdom of self-reliance. Next is self-sufficiency. Very few people have full access to our life. We may disclose things to people, but only what we want them to know. We do not want people to dig deeper. Third is the kingdom of self-protection. You tend to keep others at arm's length to guard against being hurt or rejected. The kingdom of self-protection. Fourth, it's self-importance. We tend to be addicted to busyness. It's the way we fill the void of deep relationships in our lives, right? Finally, fifth, kingdom of self-will. You regularly choose work and hobbies over people. This means schedule and priorities take precedence over the joyful sacrifice of serving others. Any of these self-expressions of the self, can you relate to any of them? The question is for all of us, how do we need to repent from those self-expressions this morning? But this is the good news, shifting into my last point, okay? I'm so glad that I never have to end a sermon right there. We'd be like, going home depressed. It's good that Jesus came to free us from the works of the enemy, the works of Satan. He came to overcome them. He came to free us from the kingdom of self, the kingdom of Satan, and transfer us into the kingdom of light, with all the other God-absorbed subjects of the beloved Son, Jesus. And he came to do that not because of our own doing or our own ability or our own goodness, but he came to do that because of his great grace and love towards his people. And he wants us to continually wake up to the joy of living in that kingdom community. Okay? It's joy. It's for your good, right? Don't fight it. Don't fight it. It's for your good. Embrace what you've been designed for and ultimately what you've been recreated in Christ for. Last point, recreated for community. You see how I did that? You like that, huh? Huh? The parentheses and the re and then the recreate. You like that, don't you? I know you do, Mark. Stop that back there. All right. You may be wondering what I mean by the term recreated for community. I'm playing off this concept that I was using earlier. If God designed humankind to reflect the loving triune community we see within the Godhead, a capacity for that type of community was lost in the fall. The good news is that it is all regained in the person and work of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, our Redeemer. When we talk about recreation, it means, it reminds us that we stand in need of the Lord to do something significant within us, right? It says we need, right? We need his help, right? Or it's not going to happen. We need him to overcome the brokenness that runs all the way to our core, to change us, to start something brand new that we don't feel like we have the ability to accomplish, right? I mean, that's this beauty. Like, I've been hurt a lot as a pastor in my occupation. I just have. It's the way things. People come and go. I've been hurt deeply by people. You know, they said some nasty things about me, right? But it is the fact that I have Christ that I'm enabled to do it again, to open my heart up again and run headlong into loving other people and drawing into them and having a sense that, God, this is what you want and this is what I was created for, and to do this is to find joy and meaning, right? We need God's help. And you see this type of idea in the language of 2 Corinthians 4, the recreation language, and 5:17. Paul is alluding back to Genesis 1:3 in the physical creation as he draws a parallel to what's happening in salvation. Let me explain it for you. Humankind that is under the bondage and blindfold of Satan is a part of the old fallen creation. But when and where the gospel is preached and God in his sovereign grace opens the heart of a person so that the darkness of unbelief is chased away by the light and saving knowledge of the divine Son, the dawn of new creation begins in a person. Oh, this is dirty preaching. I'm getting excited. Okay, it happens when a person is enabled to see Jesus for who he truly is. That's when it happens. When we look into the face of Jesus, and because of the sovereign grace of God, when we look in the face of Jesus, we rightly see the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. That's called salvation. And it is beautiful. 2 Corinthians 4:4-6 says, in their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. Look at verse 6. For God who said, light, let light shine out of darkness. Remember the physical creation, Genesis 1. That same God who said that, listen to what Paul says, has shown in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. New creation. Similar ideas found in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a what? New creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. In the Greek language, which the New Testament is written in, the to be verb is not there. So it literally says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, new creation. New creation. Okay? And I'm just tying some themes together in the New Testament, okay? This is what I'm going to do right now. I'm going to tie some themes together. The last Adam, Jesus. Do you know he's the last Adam? The last Adam, Jesus, 1 Corinthians 15. The perfect man shows us what it's like to love God fully and to love his neighbor as himself. The last Adam shows us what it's like to truly flourish according to God's definition of flourishing. And it does not necessarily include riding in a Benz or a Cadillac, okay? The last Adam takes upon himself our darkness, our corruption, our sin, our judgment, and our death, and raises from the grave bodily to overcome it, so that all who are joined to Jesus, our King and Savior, by faith, to the last Adam, Jesus, will become a part of God's redeemed humanity, the new creation. The old will be passed away and the new has come. Great thought. If the first broken Adam from Genesis was the starting point of the first creation, the last glorious Adam, our resurrected King Jesus, is the starting point of the new creation. This means that when a person is found in Christ by faith, they immediately become a part of God's new world in the midst of this fallen, broken one, in a type of already but not yet reality that's been opened for us, all of those who've been linked to Christ by faith. James 1:18 says it this way: of his own will, that's God's own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth so that we should be the kind of first fruits of his creatures or his creation. Christians are seen here in James and also in Romans 8:19 through 23 as the first fruits of God's new creation. Participation in that new creation is reflected by a new way of living and loving empowered by Jesus' Spirit, 2 Corinthians 3. And it will culminate in the renewal of the whole person one day, right? Through the final resurrection from the dead into the new heavens and the new earth. And this is the truth. Being linked to the last Adam, Jesus, we are led into the new humanity that does not look like being ruled by the flesh. Where do I get that from? Galatians 5:22. You saw the list of the flesh in Galatians. It's all anti-community, okay? It's all anti-community. But what does the Spirit produce in a person? What does he produce? Y'all read it with me. But the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. You know what we just described? Jesus, perfectly. I got a question. If the Spirit of God, who creates a person anew in Christ and brings them into the true humanity, the new creation, if God's Spirit lives inside of a person, and throw those traits back up there one more time, Michael, if you don't mind. If these traits are at work in a person, how's your marriage going to go? How's that community going to go? It's going to be a lot different, right? What does it look like if your coworkers all possess that type of living? It's going to be different. What does it look like if your church is made up of people who give allegiance to the Jesus who saved them and loved them and redeemed them and brought them into the new creation? It's going to look totally different. Where the Spirit is at work, true community becomes a possibility. Where flesh reigns, the possibility of true community is shattered. And one author says, one of the chief things that Jesus accomplishes when he redeems us is to restore our capacity for community. Listen, I love this part. The author says, not for a community of people who look and act like us, but a community of people who, although very diverse, look and act like him. Don't you want to be a part of that community? I mean, I say that in the big sense, in the sense of, like, if you're not a Christian, you need Jesus, right? You need him to redeem you. You need him to work so much in your life that he makes you new, that he pours his Spirit out in you, okay? Don't you want to be a part of that community first, right? And then I say it in a greater sense, don't you want to be a part of a community where Jesus is king and his Spirit is at work in us? I do. And you can have that today by faith. Finally, as I wrap up, I just want to say I had a couple of things left. I don't know if I'm going to have time, but it's so interesting in the New Testament that when we think about this concept of community, when we think about Jesus, that it's not, like I said, just that God's Spirit comes to connect us to God, but God's Spirit comes in to connect us to his family. And you don't have one without the other, right? The community of Christ is a package deal that comes with the blessing of being saved, right? So the New Testament, every time they're talking about the people of God, they use a type of community-focused metaphor. And that's what I want to conclude with when they talk about the church of the living God. Five ways I want to want to show you this, and I'm going to go through them very quickly. First, God talks about his people as a flock, right? Right? John 10, 14 through 16. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, I lay down my life for them, the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, right? One shepherd. Luke 12, 32 says, God, or Jesus speaking, fear not, little flock. What are you? You're a little flock. For it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. So we are individual sheep if we've been born again into his family that make up a flock. We are not, according to this passage, lone wolves, right? Second metaphor, community metaphor. The church is God's vine. John 15, 5, Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. Guys, in case you didn't know this, this is very helpful. But in the original language, many times when they're talking about the you in English, it does not translate like it's supposed to. In the original language, it's supposed to translate as y'all. Okay, it happens all the time. You'll be reading your English Bible and you're like, it's just me and Jesus. And he's like, it's supposed to be plural. This is one of the many examples of that, right? I'm the vine, y'all are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. We are a group of branches that are connected to the vine. We aren't a sticky single cactus, okay? We're not that. Third community metaphor, the church is God's body. 1 Corinthians 12, 27. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it, right? That metaphor of the body is like six times in the New Testament. Listen, separate, isolated, divided, we are not who God intended us to be. Some of us are the eye and some of us are the foot, right? Okay. This means we are never complete without the rest of the body in which Christ is the head. Never complete. We aren't just random disconnected body parts laying around. I mean, just think about it. That's a car wreck, right? That's something that's bad, okay? In Christ, we are connected. Jesus is our head, right? And you, my brothers and sisters, are a part of the body, right? Last metaphor. I know people are getting tired out there. The church is the temple of the living God. The building of God. 1 Corinthians 3, 7 says, we are God's building. 1 Corinthians 3, 16 says, do you not know that y'all are God's temple? Throw that up there. Let me show them that Southern translation. Do I not have that one? I'm sorry. I might not have that one. 1 Corinthians 3, 16. Do you not know that y'all, you are God's temple and that God's spirit dwells in you? Ephesians 2, 18 through 21. For through him we both have access into one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. We are a bunch of individual stones that God has made into a beautiful house that he lives within by his Spirit. And the whole thing is joined and kept together from crumbling because of our cornerstone, Jesus Christ. Beautiful, beautiful. And finally, the main New Testament metaphor that God uses when speaking of his church is the what? Drum roll, please. What's the main New Testament metaphor that he uses to speak about his people? Anybody know? No, that was close. Yes. Joel said children. So the metaphor is the
family.
Yeah, family. There you go. All right, the family. 2 Corinthians 6:18. He says, and there's like 15 verses, and I'm just going to list a couple of them. 2 Corinthians 6:18, I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. Matthew 12, 49 through 50. Stretching out his hands towards his disciples, he said, Jesus speaking, here are my mothers and my brothers, for whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. Isn't that beautiful? Galatians 6:10, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially those who are of the household of faith. 1 Timothy 5:1, do not rebuke an older man, but encourage him as you would a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters, in all purity. It shows the family aspect of the body of Christ. I'm just really thankful the metaphor for God's people isn't a sorry game of solitaire. You know what I'm saying? Or God's people's like an island. They're all by themselves, right? I'm so thankful it's not that way. We are part of God's family if you've been recreated in Christ. He is our Father. Christ is our elder, perfect brother. And every believer is our sibling. We are his flock. We are his body. We are his temple, his grapevine, all for his glory. And as we conclude, I'm asking for Kurt to come up, and we're going to sing some songs and close it out. But I'm asking you to be honest with yourself, and I'm going to be honest with myself, and let's ask ourselves, what are we doing to resist true community? What you were made for? What God designed you for? Is there anything, bitterness, anger, fear, pride, selfishness that we need to repent of? God's grace is sufficient. He opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble this morning, right? Is there a journey group we should join this rotation? Sign up in the back. Call the journey group leader. Is there a family you should have over, or a men's and women's group you should be a part of, or a service you should attend, or a youth group you should be involved in, or a friendship you should invest in, or a marriage that you should cultivate? Let's do that today. We were created for community. And now, by God's sovereign grace, we've been recreated in Christ Jesus for the type of community that the world longs for. You have the privilege to be a part of that community where the world will look in from the outside and say, those people are not perfect, but they have something that I don't have. And because they have that, they love each other and they do not give up on each other. All for the glory of God in the world. Lord, would you make connection fellowship the type of people that don't have religion, but they have you, Jesus. And because we have you, we would be empowered to live in community, even when it's hard, even when it's tough, even when people hurt our feelings. We would do that sacrificially with joy because you are worth it. And these are your people. And this is the local expression that we have here at Connection, and we want it to reflect you, Jesus, for the glory of your name. So put our hearts in line with you. Bring harmony in the midst of your people. And we pray all of this thankful in Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let's stand together, and you respond, and we'll sing together.
to see and save the lost. He paid it all upon the cross. Yes. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. Let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. Let your name be lifted higher. Stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord. You are stronger, you are stronger, sin is broken. Won't you be my life? Oh, I surrender. One day is better with you than all the world. Oh, Spirit of life, help me remember that it is my pleasure to say to you that all I am, my life, by I've been crucified with Christ. Oh, the life I live, I live by faith in Jesus Christ who lives in me. My heart grows cold and my flesh is failing. Oh, the Spirit is willing to point me back to you. For to live is Christ and to die is better. Help me remember my song to you. I've been crucified. atoning. His body broken for me. Remember his approval. He gave his life to say so. Remember his appealing, oh, right now. The Lord is interceding. Remember if you have breath, breathe it out and praise him.
Have been crucified with Christ. We have been. It is no longer we who live, but Christ who lives within us. The life that we now live, we live not in the flesh, but we live in the Spirit through faith in the Son of God who loved Himself and gave Himself for us. You are loved and you are sent. You are dismissed. Thank you.